With me is Lord Grade, formerly head of the BBC, ITV and Channel 4. Michael, thank you for taking part. What do you think has happened to television?
Well, more competition has made life a lot tougher. That's competition, there are more channels, competition from the internet and so on. So life is a lot harder today for broadcasters, traditional broadcasters. And I think they've got to work a lot harder, which is the lesson from America, about creating distinction on their channel with their content. You know, you see the new Netflix and people in America doing these amazingly brilliant, quite adventurous, quite innovative drama series. We've got to work harder. The old formulas aren't good enough anymore to distinguish your service.
Do you think the internet will eventually kill off television?
No, because the internet is just a delivery system. It needs content. And whoever can provide content, and the leaders of content provision are essentially the Hollywood studios and the traditional broadcasters, and the internet needs that stuff in order to attract users.
And what's happened to the indies in the UK?
Well, the independent sector is one of the huge success stories of the UK of the last 20 years. It's grown, it's consolidating now, which is just a sign of the market's maturing, but it's been a huge success story to the extent that if the indies disappeared tomorrow, I think ITV, Channel 4 and the BBC would really struggle.
And what's happened to investigative journalism on terrestrial television in the UK?
It's less prevalent than it used to be, but that's for good commercial reasons. There's still more investigative journalism on British television than most free world networks, but there isn't as much as there used to be, and I'm afraid that's economics.
Is it dying?
I don't think it's dying, because as long as there are journalists, there are people who want to break stories and investigate. The BBC is in the vanguard of that. I don't think a great deal of their investigative journalism at the moment, but that's just a phase thing. I think it will no doubt improve.
Does the standing army that made the Birmingham 6 investigation exist anywhere in today's television?
I don't think it does. I don't think the kind of investment that Granada and Thames Television and London Weekend and others used to put into keeping a regular team of investigative journalists working round the clock 52 weeks a year with no certainty that they were going to get a story at the end of it, a film at the end of it. I think those days have gone. The economics are just against it.
Should the BBC have exposed the MP's expenses scandal?
I don't think it was... I think, you know, you've got to give credit. Stories fall where they fall. It depends on contacts and so on. What would have been wrong is if the BBC had the story and sat on it, which they did with the Jimmy Savile film, or they tried to.
Would it have been politically possible for the BBC to do the MP's expenses scandal?
Absolutely possible, yes. I have no doubt that if the BBC had got those tapes, that data, I have no doubt they would have published.
Could the BBC have broken the phone hacking scandal at News International?
Again, I think if the BBC had got the story, they absolutely would have published, yes.
It would have been politically possible?
Oh, absolutely, yes. Yes, I've never known a case in 30 or 40 years in broadcasting where the BBC has been leaned on and not published a story. You just can't get away with that at the BBC. The public wouldn't stand for it, and the news would leak that the story had been killed by those upstairs, whoever they are. It just would never happen. It couldn't possibly happen.
Why were these stories broken by the newspapers, do you think, and not television?
Well, television breaks stories. It's just the luck of where the story falls. Who's got the contacts? Who's got the information? You know, no organisation, no newspaper, no broadcaster has got an exclusive on exclusives. You know, they fall where they fall, and that's luck, really.
Do you think that the whole of UK television has let down the victims of historic sex abuse over 50 years?
I think this is such a complex story I don't think there's anyone singularly to blame, because I don't believe, but we'll see what the BBC independent report says about who knew what. If they knew and they hushed it up, then that is a very serious matter. If they didn't know, then you have to ask, why didn't they know? Why didn't the victims come forward and complain? It's a very complex story, very complex story. But we'll see what the Janet Smith report reveals, which I think is going to be published very shortly, and that will help us.
Why do you think the BBC self-censored its own Jimmy Savile investigation?
I think it was a complete cock-up, total cock-up from the beginning. Most scandals at the BBC of an editorial nature are a cock-up. I think that the news, I don't know for sure, I've read the report, the Horrocks report. It seemed to me that the editor of Newsnight thought, actually, Newsnight is not the place to be running celebrity exposés. It's not really a Newsnight story. I've somehow got myself into this, probably not right. But what he should have done then was say, well, this is such an important film, we have to get this into the public interest. I must give it to Panorama, or we must have a Newsnight special, or we must do something with it. You can't sit on a film like that. If you know what the departments of the BBC are like. You know, they're very, very protective of their own stories, and they just got it wrong.
A lot of people are asking, what's the BBC for in today's internet age? Do you think that the BBC has a unique responsibility to mount major investigations, and that that's an answer?
Journalism, no, I think it's more complex than that. Journalism, impartial journalism, and investigative journalism is at the heart of the BBC's mission, certainly. But also at the heart of the BBC's mission is to take the public's money and create wonderful programmes for radio and television, made by British producers for British audiences, with nothing on its mind other than to delight, to inform, to entertain, to educate. That's what the BBC stands for, and it is a huge engine for the creative industries in the UK.
Do you think the licence fee should be scrapped?
No, I don't, no.
Do you think it will be scrapped?
No, I don't. Not in my lifetime. I think that it's too big. I think the BBC is too big. But we need to wait and see what the devolution settlement is. You know, if we end up with the federal United Kingdom, how the BBC fits into that, how much resource is needed to sustain BBC Scotland, BBC, an independent BBC Scotland, BBC Wales, BBC Northern Ireland, BBC England. The economics of that I don't know yet. But if you've given the status quo, I think the licence fee is far too high. The BBC does too many things.
The licence fee is far too high?
Much too high, yes.
What would you do about it? Would you freeze it?
I wouldn't do anything other than start to look at the BBC from the bottom up. Look at every single line of its total budget. Why are we doing that? Is that nice to have, or is it essential to our mission? And there are lots of things that the BBC does that they don't need to do anymore.
So if the licence fee is far too high, what do? You cut it?
No, you work out what the BBC essentially has to have in order to maintain its role at the heart of British broadcasting, radio and television, and what it doesn't need to be doing. Does it still need studios? Does it still need to produce entertainment and drama? Can we leave that to the independent sector? Do we need all these people in strategy, all these people in HR, all these people, all this post-production, all these studios? I mean, it's a massive, all this property. I mean, it's a giant organisation. It's much too big in the current world.
If the answer to those points is no, they don't, what then happens to the licence fee?
Well, you've got to work out what the core of the BBC needs.
Yeah.
To provide, do they need 4 digital networks? You know, Spectrum, even though Spectrum is more plentiful than it used to be in an analog world, it's still very precious. You know, there's a frequency debate going on inside Ofcom at the moment. Everybody's clamoring for more bandwidth and more frequency. The phone companies, everybody is. You know, the BBC's sitting on a lot of that. Does it need 4 digital channels? Why?
Yeah. Would it satisfy your position if the government said, okay, well, we hear all that, Michael, and we agree with you, so we're going to freeze the licence fee for this Parliament? Would that be sufficient, or do you want to cut?
I think you're coming at it the wrong way.
Right.
You've got to look, you've got to build the BBC up. You know, there's a phrase we use in business, which is zero budgeting. You know, you start the year, you don't start at the top and say, we're going to cut 10%. You start at the bottom and say, what is it we absolutely have to do and we absolutely need to do? And then you work out how much do we need to fund that core mission of the BBC.